American Civil War Roundtable UK's Spring Conference 2023, the Overland Campaign, April 14th through to the 16th. As usual, we have two exceptional speakers from the United States to guide us through the events of the campaign. We welcome Frank O'Reilly. Frank is a historian and author at Fredericksburg and Spotsylvania National Military Park. We also welcome Chris Mikowski. Chris is Editor-in-Chief of Emerging Civil War. You can book your tickets to this event via our website at www.acwrt.org.uk/events. Alternatively, you will find the link in the description below. We look forward to welcoming you to the 2023 Spring Conference.
First off, I thanks again for inviting us, inviting me. I know I'm really honored to be here. I really enjoyed myself. It's great to meet all these new people. So I really appreciate that, and I want to thank you for that experience. Now, in some ways, you're better off, you know, like not going to Honey Springs 7 years ago. Not because it's a bad site, but because they've actually put a lot of money into it in the past year and a half. Like, they've now actually opened up a real visitor center. Like, you know, I mean, my wife and I went once, and this is probably the most suffering she had to go on a trip. She sat at a tree while we were walking the battlefield, and she got chiggers all over her feet. That was not fun. Believe me, I heard about it the rest of the way driving back. But now it's like they've apparently cleared away a lot of the brush. There's a lot of undergrowth in the battlefield. One of the weird things about American battlefields, especially Civil War battlefields, is there's a lot fewer trees than there are now at most of the battlefields. There's also a lot more underbrush now than there was then, because a lot of times, especially most of the battlefields, farmers had pigs. They let the pigs run wild, and the pigs would eat all the underbrush. So you can actually move, troop formations could move through woods relatively easily in the American Civil War because they were relatively open and there wasn't a whole lot of underbrush. The wilderness is the exception, because that's why it is the wilderness, because there just aren't enough farmers there for the pigs to eat all the stuff on the ground. So, but yes, they apparently, when we went to Honey Springs, the bathroom facilities were a porta potty, and the visitor center was a trailer. It was maybe about the size from this first curtain here to the wall to this wall. That was it. But now they apparently have a real. And you had to go to people's backyards to get to it, too. It was not easy to get to. But apparently they have now spent a lot of money on that, and the National Park Service is actually considering making it a national battlefield park. So if you go now, it would be much, I'd like to go back now, first to see what it's like, but it apparently has gotten a lot more attention. It still does not have a book focused on the campaign, which I'm kind of surprised by, because as you'll see, it has a tremendous amount of significance and operational significance. But first, of course, again, I have to give you my disclaimer. Again, as a U.S. government official. Okay, now, I gave you a lot of context for Missouri. I have to give you more context for this. Most Americans have never heard of this battle. I mean, the day that we were at the my wife and I and some friends were at Honey Springs, we were literally the only people at the battlefield the entire day. Well, us and the chiggers were the only things at the battlefield the whole day. But it's actually, you have to go back to the War of 1812, and you have to go back to where we live now in Alabama and Georgia and Florida to understand how the Indian tribes got to Oklahoma. And that's what I'm going to talk about briefly here. You have the five civilized tribes, and these are the five civilized tribes. There's actually more tribes in Oklahoma than the five civilized tribes, but they're the biggest, they're the best organized tribes. And they're called the five civilized tribes because portions of the tribes adapted to white, economic patterns. In other words, they began to do like sedentary farming. They got into like plantation agriculture of small scale, but nonetheless they did that. And they owned slaves. Okay, so all five of these tribes owned slaves. And there was conflict between the Creeks, The Creek War of 1813-14 was particularly brutal. And of course, the Seminoles fought three wars with the United States government, and the U.S. government never did get all of the Seminoles out of Florida. They got probably about 75% of them. But the Second Seminole War was particularly brutal, a nasty guerrilla conflict, and it was actually a training ground for a lot of U.S. Army officers in terms of dealing with guerrillas and counterinsurgency. So a lot of those guys, we often talk about Mexico being the training ground for U.S. officers in the Civil War, and it was. I'm not trying to say it wasn't. But the Seminole War was too, because there's a lot of guerrilla activity going on in the American Civil War, and a lot of federal officers had to become counterinsurgents. And a lot of them cut their teeth on doing that with the government against the Seminoles in the Second Seminole War. John Ross is the most prominent figure. Ross was around for so long that he's around for the First Creek War, and he's still one of the leading members of the Cherokee tribe during the Civil War. That's how long he's been around. And that's a picture of him roughly right before he passed away during the Civil War. Now, what you have to understand, just like we have political divisions in the United States, the tribes have political divisions. And these political divisions are going to play a key role in the Civil War in Indian Territory. First off, you have to understand it's about accommodation versus resistance. A consistent theme of 19th century America, and you can argue 20th century America too, is that the Native American tribes are constantly getting screwed over by the federal government, either through military campaigns or unequal treaties, and then not honoring those treaties. This is a consistent theme of 19th century America. And what this spawns within the Indian tribes are usually two factions. One, the accommodation faction. And the accommodationists are people who are arguing that, look, we can't win against the federal government. We can't win against white settlers. There's just too many of them. And what we need to do is we need to adapt. We need to maybe adapt some of their economic models, like become farmers and this type of thing. We need to start like making languages. The Cherokees develop a written language during this time. And so we need to start adapting. And you have a lot of accommodationists marry into white society. Like they'll have a white father and an Indian mother or vice versa. Okay? Now, you have the resistance faction. The resistance faction, as you might guess, does not want to accommodate at all. If anything, they want to become more Native American. They want to reject all white practices. They do not want to become sedentary farmers. They want to continue either nomadic ways or limited agriculture that they have practiced for centuries. And they do not, and overwhelmingly, they do not integrate with whites. So you don't have like white families marrying into their families and this kind of thing. The problem is, who's right? Well, neither of them. That's the sad fact for Native Americans in the United States in the 19th century. Oh, and I should point out too, by the way, Native Americans are not citizens of the United States. That does not happen until 1924. Okay? So Native Americans don't have the same kind of constitutional protections that white Americans do. And in fact, one of the weird quirks of this is that when the 13th Amendment goes into effect in late 1865 in the United States, it does not apply to many of the Indian tribes. So Indian tribes which held slaves don't actually have to free them, but the federal government, what they do is they start, and in fact, Sam Curtis actually does this. He goes on these negotiations with the various Indian tribes, and of the treaties that are signed, the Indians must agree to free all their slaves. They have to free all their slaves and abolish all the slavery in their tribal governments and their tribal laws. And so by 1866, slavery really is outlawed in the United States. Although, of course, after the one speaker yesterday, California had wondered about that. But in the background of this accommodation versus resistance kind of conflict, you have Andrew Jackson's presidency. Jackson, yes, this is the same guy from the Battle of New Orleans during the War of 1812. In fact, that's what propels him to the presidency. He becomes a national hero. And he becomes a two-term president, a very significant two-term president in our history. Jackson had a very, let's just say, complex relationship with Native Americans. Jackson is the general during the Creek War who annihilates the Red Sticks. And when I say annihilates, I'm not kidding about that. He basically, the Red Sticks fight this battle called Horseshoe Bend, not too far from where I live in central Alabama. It's a perfectly preserved battlefield, by the way. It's out in the middle of nowhere. But what the Red Sticks have done is they've, in effect, trapped themselves on a bend in the river, and Jackson surrounds them, and he says the order of the day is to exterminate. That's a direct quote. That's not me hyperbole. That is a direct quote. Exterminate the Red Sticks. And they do. It starts out as a battle, but turns into a massacre. The Red Sticks understand that there's going to be no quarter given, and they fight very desperately, but in the end, the superior firepower of the U.S. military and the Tennessee Volunteers is just too much for the Red Sticks to overcome. And so the Red Sticks rebellion is destroyed pretty decisively by Jackson. But Jackson comes to feel, even though he admires many things about Native Americans, he comes to feel that the only way to save Native Americans is to get them out. In other words, whites will never accept Native Americans as equals, and we need to get them out to save them. And so Congress passes the Indian Removal Act in 1830, which is going to move the tribes, basically what become the five civilized tribes, out of their homelands in Georgia, Alabama, Mississippi, parts of Louisiana, and Florida, and move them to the Indian Territory in Oklahoma. This is an uneven process, and also a very tragic process, as evidenced by the Indian name for it, the Trail of Tears. Removal does not take place instantaneously. It takes place over a series of over decades. And it also is not one tribe at a time. It's more of a staggering across the area. And one of the things you have to do, 15,000 of the 100,000 Indians removed die along the way. When I tell my undergraduates this, they're like, well, why did they die? It's because they had to walk. Okay, they had to walk. A lot of times in the winter, the government contractors that the government military used to deal with them oftentimes basically cheated them out of, they would take the good stuff and then sell the bad stuff to the Native Americans and then sell the good stuff to the whites. It's just a terrible, mismanaged, horrific tragedy. But, I mean, look at that's 15% of the Native Americans who went died along the way. And here are the roots. You see here, down here are the Seminoles. This is the Creeks, the Cherokees, the Chickasaws, the Choctaws, and here is where they're going. These lines here are the routes that they take. It's not one single place. If you, I know several of you have been to the Pea Ridge battlefield. When you go to the one site at Elkhorn Tavern, they have a little plaque about the Trail of Tears. Well, that's because it went through Northwest Arkansas at one point. And so this is about I have the number down here. This is about an 800 mile trip, about 700 miles or 1,126 kilometers. Try to keep it in English so you can, or in metrics so you can understand it, get a grip of understand that. That's a long way to walk, especially when you're not given regular food, you're not given shelter or blankets. The resistance folks who go, they did not make any preparations. They were told, you need to leave by this date, and if you don't, we're going to force you out. Well, they refused to leave and they were forced out. Oftentimes given 10 minutes to pack up all their belongings and leave. That was it. So terrible tragedy in American history, certainly a stain on our government's history. But what's going to happen is, and how this results, this is what Indian Territory looks like in 1860-63. And you see the Cherokee, in other words, it was settled from east to west. So the Cherokees and the Choctaws were among the first to be forced out. And not surprising, that's the best land in Oklahoma. Eastern Oklahoma it's not fit for plantation agriculture, but it's actually very good for agriculture. So you can grow a lot of good stuff there, even some commercial crops, not on a big scale. But the further west you go, the less rain there is and the worse the land is. So you can see the Seminoles got the worst land because they're the last ones to get there. The Chickasaws got decent land, but this area that's leased from Cherokee Nation, even today in Oklahoma, there's not a whole lot there. I mean, this is still pretty empty space, and you're talking about you're starting to get on the high plains. So this is the situation on the eve of the Civil War. The Cherokees and the Choctaws have kind of finally gotten themselves back on their feet. They're among the more prosperous, the more wealthy of the two. The Creeks are doing okay. The Seminoles are still in abject poverty at this point. Just abject poverty. Now, there's also politics and economics involved here. You have within the tribes, missionaries are being sent to the tribes by various Christian denominations, overwhelmingly Protestant denominations, but some priests are going in those areas too. But what's going to happen here is this is going to reflect a larger split in American religious life. Many American Protestant denominations split over the slavery issue. Okay, so for example, if you're a Northern Methodist, Northern Methodists are going to say that slavery is an abomination and it's a sin against God. So if you own slave, if you're a slave owner, in other words, you're going to hell. Southern Methodists are going to argue that no, that's not correct. If you own slaves, that's a positive good. That's a reaction to the abolitionists, and they're going to argue that slavery is not a positive good because you, as a slave owner, are going to Christianize the slaves and lift them up. This is the core of the split for the Baptists and the Methodists. And of course, the Indian tribes, whoever goes there, so if it's a Southern Baptist and he proselytizes, or he's usually male missionary, but there are some females too. If he proselytizes a particular area of the tribe, they tend to not surprisingly adopt the Southern Baptist role. And conversely, if a Northern Baptist goes, the missionary, and he proselytizes, and what this is going to do is it's going to cause tension within the tribes about slavery, because the tribes have slaves. You can see there's the five tribes who have over 8,000 slaves in Indian Territory in 1861. And this is going to cause all kinds of tension. This is also going to be reflected in the divisions that were already there between the accommodationists and the resistance folks. So, any questions? Does that make sense? Okay, because I thank you. Take a deep breath. Because even you're talking about this is a cluster blank in many ways trying to explain this. So that's what's going on here. These divisions are very important to understand for what's going to happen in the Indian Territory. Now, with the coming of the Civil War, we finally got to the Civil War. With the coming of the Civil War, the federal government abandons Indian Territory. I think I mentioned yesterday how small the U.S. Army was in 1861. Well, they can't afford to keep their forts in the Indian Territory. And these tribes who had made treaties with the federal government were depending on the federal government to give them subsidies to help them out until they got on their feet, okay, after the Trail of Tears. Well, that's gone. The federal government effectively abandons the Indian Territory in the immediate aftermath of the secession crisis. And so the pro-slavery factions are going to gain control of the tribal governments. They already had a big advantage because, again, they had more money. During these wars between the U.S. government and the tribes, the resistance folks tended to get killed, so the resistance folks tend to be younger. And this is going to play, this gentleman here, Albert Pike, who's one of the more interesting figures in the Civil War in 19th century America, period, is going to play a key role for the Confederates. Trivia, Albert Pike is the only Confederate general who has a monument in Washington, D.C., okay, and it's not for him being a Confederate general. He actually was very active in the Freemason movement in the 19th century, and that's what the monument is for, his role in Freemasonry. He writes all kinds of Scottish Rite and things like that for the Masons, and he becomes a very, very prominent Mason. But he is going to basically go to the Native American tribes and negotiate, he sides with the Confederacy, and he negotiates treaties with the five civilized tribes, and others too, but mainly with the five civilized tribes. And there's a lot of debate within the tribes over whether to approve these treaties. Because first off, a lot of the anti-slavery Native Americans are like, hey, I don't want to sign a treaty with an entity that they view as evil. I mean, this is really the fundamental crux of the problem we have with our government, and this is part of the issue we still have today. Our system of government is based on cooperation and compromise. Morality issues, like when slavery becomes a moral issue, how do you compromise with that? Well, you can't. And that's really the crux of the problem. Once you start injecting morality into slavery, I mean, if you're going to argue about slavery as simply an economic issue, you can compromise on that. I mean, that's how we get the compromise of 1832, 1850. But when you start injecting religion into it, and the abolitionists are, and morality, and the abolitionists are going to do just that, how can you say, okay, it's okay to have a slave in months without an R in it? Well, you can't. If it's evil, it's always evil in their eyes. And likewise, if you believe slavery is a positive moral good, how do you compromise on that? So you see why we're getting to shooting at each other? But that's what's going to be happening here. Now, when the Confederates sign the treaties with them, these anti-slavery Indians are going to be at loggerheads, and they're going to be forced out of Oklahoma. they're going to be forced, they're basically, there's going to be, in effect, a civil war within each tribe. So if the civil war wasn't complex enough, you throw in this layer of complexity where each tribe now has a war within itself between pro and anti-slavery factions. And the anti-slavery factions are going to lose this conflict, and they're going to be forced out of Oklahoma and Indian Territory into southeastern Kansas. And I know some of you have you know, because Mike said he was at Baxter Springs, would you call southeastern Kansas a big area where there's lots of amenities and things you can say? Yeah, no. Back then, it's just prairie. And it's still, yeah, I say it still is. I've been to Baxter Springs, I know. It's still prairie, overwhelmingly. And back then, it's like, when they're forced out is late in 1860s, in early 1861, it's in the winter. Having lived in Kansas for 10 years and experienced the winter in Kansas, I would not want to be outside on the prairie in the winter with no shelter. This is a massive humanitarian crisis. The Indian agents in southeastern Kansas are telling the Lincoln administration, hey, we need help. We cannot accommodate all these people here. We need to do something about this. And they start thinking about, well, we could do something about this. But the Lincoln administration says no. I mean, what the Indian agents want to do is they want to enlist these men in the army. We have a manpower shortage. We got a lot of men who are angry. Let's give them guns and let's put them on our side. But the Lincoln administration says no. We're not going to do that. Because what they fear is, remember, at this time of the war, this is early 1862, late 1861. What they fear is like, hey, if we use Indians against the Confederates, they're going to accuse us of being barbarians. They're going to accuse us of using savages to put them back into place and bring them back into the fold. And we're not going to do that. But they're going to change their mind. And what changes their mind is... But there you go. The Battle of Pea Ridge.
I think that's right.
Yes. The Battle of Pea Ridge. Now, this is a very famous print. This is the Kurtz Allison print. You can see here on this, there are Indians in the picture of the Battle of Pea Ridge, okay? Now, this is not an accurate picture. This is kind of a fanciful representation of the Battle of Pea Ridge. But they are right. Native Americans did participate in the Battle of Pea Ridge. Okay, their performance left something to be desired. The Confederate units, or the Allied units with the Confederates, so technically they're not in the Confederate military. They're allies with the Confederates working with their own tribes. These units are, the Confederates did not do much to equip them. I mean, they signed the treaty, but they're not giving them a lot of weapons. And these guys are not very motivated, but the Confederates are using them. What's going to happen is this episode here, the scalping incident at Pea Ridge. And I'm sure Kyle has read about this because Curtis talks about this. And there's a minor controversy. I think the military's official term for this is kerfluffle. It was a definite full-fledged kerfluffle. What happens is the 1st and 2nd Cherokee Mounted Rifles, who are with the Confederate forces under Van Dorn, they overrun a federal artillery battery and some federal cavalry of the 3rd Iowa Cavalry. They're very excited when the federal cavalry retreats and they start war whooping and shooting guns in the air. And then they start scalping some of the dead and wounded federal soldiers. Okay, they scalp about I think it's like 8 wounded. They're found, and the evidence is clear. They did scalp them. It's not like this was a hand to hand fight. It was pretty clear what happened. And so this episode has major repercussions. Curtis, of course, when the federal military wins the Battle of Pea Ridge, they're going to say they find these mutilated bodies, and they say, hey. What happened here, Curtis writes a very strongly worded letter to Van Dorn. Van Dorn, of course, says, my men would never do something like this. He's shocked and appalled this would happen. He says, but I don't really control the Indians. It's not really my fault that this happened. And bottom line is, Lincoln says, okay, gloves are off. Let's arm these guys in Kansas. And so what they do is they start arming what becomes the Indian Brigade in southeastern Kansas. And the Indian Brigade that serves the fights with the Federals compiles a very impressive combat record. The Confederates were very frustrated because they were like, how come their Indians fight good and ours don't fight good at all? Well, these guys were very motivated. They wanted to get back to their homeland. They wanted to reclaim their homes. And they're going to put up a very creditable combat record. over the course of the fighting in the Trans-Pacific. They're veterans of Prairie Grove, they're veterans of Westport, they're veterans of course, Honey Springs here. Now, I want to shift gears a little bit and talk about the Trans-Pacific Theater and the strategic outlook here. Now, what the Federals had done after the battles of Pea Ridge and Prairie Grove is they pretty effectively controlled, Missouri's under their control. But you still have problems with guerrillas coming up the Texas Road. Weapons, men, munitions, supplies for the guerrillas. And the Missouri is just infested with guerrillas. This is a serious, serious problem with what the Federals are dealing with in guerrillas, with that. And so what the Federals are going to try and do is they're going to try and establish basically a line along the Arkansas River Valley and, of course, the Mississippi to keep the guerrillas out. And even though many of the guerrillas are already in, if they don't have guns or ammo to use, they're not nearly as effective guerrillas. I mean, if you take away all of Quantrill's men's guns, you give them a bunch of knives, yeah, they can do some damage, but not nearly as much as they can with all the weapons they have. And so that's going to be the key here, the Texas Road. And here is the Texas Road. You'll note the Texas Road goes right through Honey Springs and through Fort Gibson. The Federals decide, after Curtis's army, after Pea Ridge, marches across Arkansas in an epic march and ends up here in Helena. And Helena is the main port. In fact, it's the only port Arkansas has on the Mississippi River. But it's also going to be an important forward operating base for movement down the Mississippi for the Vicksburg campaign. Likewise, the Federals decide they have to conquer Arkansas Post, Little Rock, Fort Smith, to control the Arkansas River Valley. Now, they don't have to physically keep men at every single spot here. There are certain points along the Arkansas River that are fordable. You just have to guard them. And that's what the hope is. So they can basically guard these fords and then send other troops out of Arkansas to Western Theater and to the Eastern Theater. Now, where does Honey Springs come in here? Well, Fort Gibson is going to be crucial here for controlling the upper Arkansas River Valley. Now, is this part of their overall plans? Not initially. As you'll see, Fort Gibson and the Indian Territory are kind of an addendum, but it does play a role in this. But whoever controls the Texas Road fundamentally controls the Indian Territory. And that's what the Federals want to do ultimately, because even though Missouri, the guerrillas are not a threat to St. Louis or anything like that, Lincoln still does want to, stay in power. He wants to be reelected. He wants Republicans to stay in office. Well, if you have a bunch of Democrats who get elected because they're saying, "Hey, the guerrillas aren't doing their job, are making things miserable," they're going to put Democrats in, and so they want to get rid of these guerrillas and they want to control the Texas Road, and that's going to be very crucial here for the Indian Territory. The Honey Springs Depot is where the Confederates store all the munitions and weapons for the five civilized tribes. Okay? That's very important to understand. The Honey Springs Depot is where all the weapons and munitions are stored for the Indian tribes. And so that's going to be play a big role in this battle too. So that's the overall objective. In January of 1863, the Federals capture Arkansas Post. And then they're going to use the White River to move up, and they try and capture Little Rock several times and fail, but they're looking at bringing the whole river valley under control here. Now, some more background. You have to understand what's going on in Kansas to understand what's going on in the Indian Territory. And Kansas is a mess too, okay? Anytime Jim Lane is involved, you can pretty much, it's going to be a mess, okay? Now, Lane and Governor Kearney are both Republicans. The political differences between Lane and Kearney are not so much ideological. I mean, they generally agree. I mean, they both have taken part in the Bleeding Kansas. But the thing is that Kearney is, if there is a thing, is a moderate abolitionist. Kearney's more of a moderate abolitionist. Lane is a radical abolitionist. And the two men and their factions absolutely hate each other. But what Lane needs, and Lane needs money. Because Lane, basically, he's as corrupt as we have a phrase in the United States, he's as crooked as a $3 bill. And the reason we do that is because there is no such thing as a $3 bill. Okay, you can't get a $3 bill in the United States. Lane is going to need money. And where is Lane getting his money? He's getting his money from his military officer. James G. Blunt. Blunt is basically taking U.S. government supplies, getting them off the top, selling them, and then sending the profits back to Lane to keep him in power. Okay? I'd love to tell you that this is not the way it works, but this is sadly the way it works. And so, for Lane, the more power Blunt has, the more money he has. Likewise, Carney wants to minimize the power that Lane and Blunt have, because he's trying to diminish them and get a firmer control over the Kansas state government. But what is going to change things dramatically is this guy here, everybody's famous hater, John Schofield. When Curtis is removed by President Lincoln, not by Governor Gamble, as the commander of the Department of the Missouri, he is going to, there's a little bit of a transition period, but eventually Schofield is going to be put in charge of the Department of Missouri. And Schofield hates Blunt even more than Carney does, if that's even possible. Schofield is a West Pointer. He is a regular Army guy through and through. He is absolutely, very moderate in his political inclinations. He's certainly not an abolitionist. And he feels Blunt is the luckiest general on the planet. He finds it amazing that Blunt's recklessness has not destroyed the force under his command at this point. And he does not want to express his luck. He wants to get rid of Blunt. But the problem is, Blunt has key friends in Washington, Lane. And so, as long as Lane is protecting Blunt, and Blunt's giving money to Lane, this is a symbiotic relationship, and Schofield wants to break that. So Schofield's first step is to bring in this guy, Thomas Ewing. And he's going to split the District of Kansas into two separate districts, the District of the Border and the District of the Frontier. And here's what that looks like. There we go. Now, if you're familiar with Kansas at all, and this is still true today as it was in 1863, the vast majority of the population of Kansas lives in that northeastern part of the state, where you see Topeka, Lawrence, Kansas City, Leavenworth. When you get down past, like where the Marina Shay and Mine Creek battlefield are, there's nothing, okay? And let's put it this way, it's hard to skim money off of nothing. That's gonna be a big driver here, okay? Now, Ewing also is he's not a regular Army guy, but he also hates Blunt, by the way. Ewing is, by the way, Sherman's stepbrother. And in a weird quirk of fate, he's also Sherman's brother-in-law. Which I'm not going to get into that either, but you get the idea. So yeah, Sherman married his stepsister. He was adopted, he married his stepsister. Pardon? I wasn't going to bring that up. That's on you. You brought that up. Thank you for that. Okay? So this is a part of the problem here, is that Blunt is being pressured by Lane. You have to do something. Because you need to win victories. If you don't win some kind of victory for us, they're gonna basically like administer you out of any kind of power at all. In fact, Blunt even writes to Lane at one point, the higher my rank goes, he's a major general in the Army now, the higher my rank goes, the fewer men I seem to have under my control. So this is something that Blunt has to do something to change this dynamic. And this is what is gonna be actually a very big stimulus to the Battle of Honey Springs. I'd like to tell you that this is part of some grand strategy. It actually does fit into federal grand strategy very nicely, but that's not why the battle was taking place. The battle was fundamentally about graft. Okay? Now, Colonel William Phillips, he's in charge of at least part of the Indian Brigade, and Blunt in April is going to send him to take Fort Gibson. And Fort Gibson is the site of today's Fort Gibson in Oklahoma. And Fort Gibson is a national historic site, so you can go see the remnants of Fort Gibson if you go there today. Now, William Phillips is going to start rebuilding the fortifications at Fort Gibson. He renames it Fort Blunt because he understands where his bread is buttered, too. And so he's going to be there. Now, Gibson is going to be there for several months, and he gets indications from his spies that he has sent out. That's one thing. Blunt, part of the reason Blunt seems to win all these battles, Schofield attributed to luck. It wasn't luck at all. Blunt has a very extensive spy network through the Indians in his under his command. And so one always gets advance warning of what the competitors are going to do. So it's not that he somehow, I mean, the competitors are like, how does he do that? Well, he does that because he has moles within your ranks and he's getting the information directly from them. So Blunt knows what these competitors are doing very quickly, and he can react very quickly. And surprisingly enough, the Indian Brigade seems to have very good security intelligence. They don't seem to let Leakes leave their ranks for their compatriots on the Confederate side. So Phillips basically tells Blunt, hey, I'm going to be attacked. I need your help. And Blunt is going to react. And I think it's time to talk a little bit about Blunt as a person. You can see Blunt is not a professional military guy. He was a doctor. He becomes an abolitionist. But the thing with Blunt Lane is you're never sure if he's like sincere in his abolitionism or he just sees this as a way to make money. Let's just say that Blunt Lane's actions, while you may say, oh, that's admirable being an abolitionist, I don't know that you can say it's a sincere desire because he believes all people are equal. I think he sees money signs. And it just happens to coincide with what's the right thing to do. But Blunt is going to become, he takes part in leading Kansas. He knows John Brown. He knows John Brown personally. He knows some of these leading figures in leading Kansas because he's taking part in it. And thanks to Lane, he gets promoted to Brigadier General in April 62. He fights the Battle of Prairie Grove, and it's considered a victory, not an overwhelming victory, but he gets promoted to Major General on March of 1863. The thing you have to understand about Blunt as a commander is that he is well-named. He is a blunt force. Tactics are not his strong suit. He will just attack whoever he finds. He is aggressive to the point of recklessness. And it's understandable why Schofield is a little bit leery about Blunt, because Blunt does do things that are risky that you shouldn't do. He does violate military like logic consistently, but he always gets away with it. He always gets away with it, which of course drives Schofield nuts, because Schofield can't stand this guy who he considers a rank amateur, in his own words, keeps winning these battles, and Schofield, by the way, is not winning many battles. Blunt's the guy winning all the battles. And so this is the guy who's going to be in charge of the federal forces at Honey Springs. Now his opponent, this gentleman here, Douglas Cooper. We don't hear a whole lot about him. He's nowhere near as colorful. He also doesn't have the same kind of records available to study him. You see, Cooper also gets ahead because of his political patron, a guy named Jefferson Davis. Cooper basically had worked with Davis in the Mexican War. He fought with Davis at the Battle of Buena Vista. Davis rewards him when Davis becomes Secretary of War in the Franklin Pierce administration. And he eventually raises the first Choctaw, first Chickasaw. He's made a Brigadier General in May of 1862. He is a much more even-keeled person. And all the accounts of Blunt, and there are a fair number of them, by the way, Blunt is fiery, ill-tempered, combative, a very disagreeable person is how Schofield describes him, at least on several occasions. And so Douglas Cooper is a much more affable fellow. He seems to get along with people, and he also is a competent military leader. But as we're going to see, he is going to be at a big disadvantage here at Honey Springs. Now, I want to talk a little bit about the armies. Now, to call these two forces armies is probably a stretch. We're talking 3,000 men on each side. In the Eastern Theater, this would be hardly a skirmish. And it would probably not even make the newspapers in terms of that. But in the Indian Territory, this is actually a big force. This is the biggest battle fought in Indian Territory during the entire war. Not the only battle, but the biggest battle. And what's interesting about this is that, you know, you look at that, the first, one of the more interesting units is the 1st Kansas Colored, commanded by Colonel James Williams. Now, the 1st Kansas Colored is not the first African-American unit raised, but it is the first African-American unit to see combat in the Civil War. And it sees combat in October of 62 at a place called Island Mound, Missouri. If you go there actually is a nice little park there now. They're still not sure exactly the exact spot of it where it took place, but they know have a pretty good idea of roughly where it is. And And this little skirmish takes place in a very isolated part of Missouri today. I think it's Butler County, Missouri. If you're looking for all kinds of like great restaurants and stuff to eat, no, you're gonna have to keep going. But it's still worth seeing. It is still, it's a nice park. The first Kansas Colored, unlike the more famous 54th Massachusetts, the 54th Massachusetts, which is the unit for the movie Glory, I'm sure most of you have probably seen that. The 54th Mass is a majority of them are freed African Americans. In other words, they were never slaves. These guys are almost 100% runaway slaves from Missouri. And believe me, they are motivated. That's one thing Blunt learns very quickly, is that this is his best unit in terms of motivation, cohesion, unit morale, discipline. This is his best unit. And he's not afraid to use it consistently. And you'll notice the first Kansas Colored, not USCT yet. They are eventually taken over by the United States government because in the United States government, they don't allow black commissioned officers. When the first Kansas Colored is raised, they do have black commissioned officers. Now, Colonel Williams is not African American, but his lieutenants, his lieutenant colonels, they're all African American. Okay, so the vast majority of the officer corps in this unit is African American. Okay, and yes, that means commissioned officers and non-commissioned officers. So this is also the biggest unit in the Army as well. You can see here you have several, you have several Native American units. These are the 1st and 2nd Indian Home Guards. These are some of the units in the 3rd Indian Home Guards Regiment. These are the units that were raised in the aftermath of the Battle of Pea Ridge. And again, these guys are very motivated as well. They're not as well disciplined as the 1st Kansas Colored, but they're still quality troops. And so when you look at Blunt's army, about 3,000 men and 12 guns, it's not that big, but it's very cohesive. They are very motivated. They're very well disciplined. And this is a really quality fighting force. I know that, again, there's still debate about Blunt and why he wins. I think I know why he wins. I've seen his records in the National Archives. He's getting all these reports from these spies on a regular basis. He's winning as you would say, Eric, he's winning the information war. Okay? He has information dominance over his opponents. His opponents don't know where he is, but he knows exactly where they are. And Blunt actually has a better idea of how many men they have than Cooper has of his own force. So that should tell you right there that Blunt has a big advantage. Oh, and he has these 12 guns. Now, we're not talking a massive artillery train, but compared to what the Confederates have, it's competently managed, it's competently run, and it's going to be very effective at the Battle of Honey Springs. So it's a small army, but it's a cohesive army. It's a very highly motivated force. Now, their opponents, I had to go with two, because even though the Confederate army is larger, I split into two sections. This is the Texas portion of Douglas Cooper's army. You can see that he has the 20th Texas Cavalry, the 29th Texas Cavalry. All of those units are mounted, but all of them fight dismounted. Okay, so you'll see like the 20th Texas Cavalry and 20th Texas Cavalry, for example, are going to fight dismounted at the Battle of Honey Springs. They're not going to be on horseback. Their horses will be behind the lines, and they will basically use them to retreat when it comes to it. And the artillery, you have it's only like, three separate pieces of artillery. I think they only have three or four total. And you can see here is the Indian allies of the Confederates. Stan Waite I have starred here, and that's because Stan Waite is not actually going to be at the Battle of Honey Springs. He was sent on a diversion to try and distract Blunt, and it didn't work. Again, Blunt knew it was a diversion. He said, okay, if he's not going to fight me, then I'll let him go. That's less troops I have to deal with. So, now record keeping for the Confederates and their Indian allies is very spotty. The best guess is that there's around 3,000 to 3,500 men and 4 guns. Now, I will say Blunt in his dispatch, he argues that the Confederates and Indians had over 6,000 men. But his intel reports are telling you they have 3,500. I think Blunt is trying to get, again, remember, he's trying to get more better press for himself. I beat a big army, okay? So you have to take some of Blunt's public pronouncements in the newspaper with a little bit of a grain of salt. Okay, now, finally get to the Battle of Honey Springs. Well, actually, before I get to that one, I want to set the stage here. Blunt is going to basically get this message from... Okay, stop. Blunt's going to get this message from Jim Lane saying, you need to get down there and do something. Win me a battle in early July. Of course, news of Gettysburg, news of Vicksburg is coming. They know that, okay? They want to... Blunt feels... Lane feels that Blunt has to get in on the victory parade. We've had big victories. We need to add to that. And of course, there's also a big victory in the Battle of Helena on July 4th, Helena, Arkansas. And Lane's like, you've got to get in there and get me a victory so I can get more money. And so Blunt decides to take his men. It takes him about, it's about 3 or 4. He has to go from Fort Scott, Kansas, down to Honey Springs. And that is, he has to go 175 miles or 281 kilometers in 5 days. And he does it. Again, his army is very well disciplined. And so the night before the battle, or 2 nights before the battle, on July 15th, Blunt decides to go and attack Cooper's army, which is at the Honey Springs Depot. He knows that Cooper is hoping to link up with troops from Fort Smith, Arkansas, and they're going to be open. Close to triple his number, and so he wants to get there before they unify. In some ways, it's kind of a classic Napoleonic thing, get the middle position and then attack the one force. That's what he's trying to do, which again, I think Schofield just rolled over his grave hearing me talk about, you know, this Blunt using a Napoleonic tactic here. But nonetheless, that's what Blunt's going to be doing. And so Blunt is going to basically get to about 15 miles away the night before the battle. Now, Blunt is sick. And historians are not sure what he has. Some historians say he has encephalitis. Some say that he has some kind of syphilis complication. And others say that he basically just has like some kind of like a really bad flu or something. Anyway, whatever the case is, he's sick. He passes out in the saddle the day before the battle. He gets propped up on the saddle, and he manages to drive his troops. So that on the morning of the battle, July 17th, Blunt's leading elements are at in front of the Elk Creek, which is right before Honey Springs, and he has to wait for his army to get there. Now, Blunt is going to make sure that the rest of his army comes up about 9 a.m. And of course, I should point out this is a key point too. Blunt drove his army in a driving rainstorm the night before. It rained very, very hard at the Honey Springs Depot and all along the march for the Federals. So at 9 o'clock in the morning, Blunt decides to get his army ready to go. Everybody is there, and they decide to attack the Confederates. And here is the speech that Colonel Williams, part of the speech that Colonel Williams gives to the 1st Kansas Colored. Now think about that. You're in the ranks, and you're being told that this is a war to put you and your wives and children back in slavery. You think that's going to motivate you to fight? Yeah, I think so. It's a great classic American tradition before football games or at halftime for the coach to give a speech and have the team run through a wall to get out of the field. This is basically a precursor to that. These guys were ready to go. I mean, this Colonel Williams says, if my men were chomping at the bit, we wanted to get at the enemy. They could not wait. And they're going to do very well with that. Now, I saw in the program there is a map of Honey Springs. And basically, the map, you have to understand, the top over here, this is north. Okay, so it should kind of be this way. But when I had it that way, it just got so small, it became very difficult to see. Blunt is going to get his force into position. Cooper's going to move his army north of Elk Creek here. This, by the way, is the Texas Road. Okay, this is the key. This is one of the key things about the battle. This we fought directly on the Texas Road. The key element here is the 1st Kansas Colored at the center of the line. You have the artillery here. There's going to be about a two-hour artillery barrage, I guess with four guns if you want to call it a barrage. A barrage Indian Territory style. Okay? More of a bam, bam. Bam, as opposed to like something like you'd see it like the third day of Pickett's charge in Gettysburg. This is a much more, but it is a, it is an effective artillery preparation. Essentially, the Confederate artillery is knocked out by the Federals before the charge happens. The Confederates are also under, there's a tree line along here, and the Confederates are in the tree line waiting for the Federal attack. And the Federal attack is going to come, and it's going to be about an hour and a half, 2 hour slugfest at about 100 meters between the two sides. And it's going to be a back and forth affair. What is going to change, what's going to change the dynamic here is that the 1st Kansas starts to charge, and when the 29th Texas, the commander of them yells to stand up and yells to fire, the 1st Kansas dies for cover. They get down on the battlefield. The Texas regiment thinks for some reason they're retreating, and they charge after them. Well, the 1st Kansas simply gets up and fires a volley right in their face at no more than 10 meters. And the 29th Texas panics at that point. They assume that the African-American unit was going to run. Again, I'm sure some of their prejudices about African-Americans were at work here. And basically, when the 29th Texas runs, the rest of the Confederate line begins to unravel. And it becomes a race to the bridges over Elk Creek. And the Confederates are, most of them are going to make it there, but it's going to be a disorganized mob. Now, the Cooper does have these units in reserve to try and stop the Confederates from, retreating and trying to set a new line. They're overwhelmed by the retreating force. And guess who is leading the pursuit? The 1st Kansas has smelled blood, and they are going after the Texas cavalrymen that were after them. And they are going to be ruthless in terms of prosecuting the retreat. This is something you don't see very often in Civil War battlefields. One side will retreat, the other side will say, we're so kind of worn out, we're just not going to pursue you. And that's not the way Blunt works. Blunt's going to go for blood every time. And so Blunt is leading these guys, they're going aggressively after them, and it's going to play a big role in this, because the Cooper realizes that, my God, if they capture the Honey Springs Depot, we're totally screwed here. I'm paraphrasing there, but that's basically what he realizes. Because remember, what's at the Honey Springs Depot? The entire weapons and magazines for the Indian Territory. So food, supplies, not to mention guerrillas who are coming north on the Texas Road are getting supplies and weapons to go into Missouri. If the Confederates lose that, they're really in big trouble. And that's exactly what happens. Blunt very aggressively pursues, again led by the 1st Kansas Colored. Cooper tries to set the depot on fire, but because it had rained very hard the night before, it doesn't catch on fire. And so the depot falls virtually intact into the hands of the 1st Kansas and the Army of the Water. As you can imagine, these guys are taken out, they're putting hands on their bayonets and biscuits and bread and taking it all. Because even though Blunt moves aggressively and they do get fed, they're not living high on the hog here. I mean, there probably aren't that many like overweight. Let's put it this way: if you see a reenactor looking like me, it's not a good reenactor. Okay, that's the big problem that they have. So these guys are lean, they're hungry, and they stop to eat, and they decide to destroy what they can't carry with them. And so the Honey Springs Depot is gone. And this is going to have a catastrophic response. Well, there's also a very unpleasant discovery that the 1st Kansas uncovers at the Honey Springs Depot. They found 500 pairs of manacles. And from one of the captured Confederate cavalrymen, the manacles were apparently going to be used to re-enslave the members of the 1st Kansas Colored. As you can imagine, they were not too happy to hear about that. And they have to be restrained from killing the Texas cavalrymen right there on the spot. So this is going to be, and here's a picture of the 1st Kansas Colored. Now, again, it's not a photograph, certainly, but my guess is that this is reasonably accurate because this was one of the best equipped units in the Trans-Mississippi. Best equipped, best led, best drilled, highly motivated. I mean, these guys are, Blunt, unlike a lot of Federal Army officers who are very leery about using African-American units, Blunt doesn't have many units, period, under his command. And when he has a good one, he's going to use it. And he's going to use it a lot. In fact, Blunt writes a letter to a Leavenworth conservative that very quickly makes his way to the New York Times, describing the performance of the 1st Kansas Colored. apparently Blount wasn't kidding when he said that. Because you, it's one thing to say something, but you can judge a person by his actions. Blount consistently gave the First Kansas the toughest assignments when he was in command of them. And they consistently delivered for him. So he had a tremendous amount of confidence in these guys, and they're going to reward that confidence. Now, the casualty figure, as you can see, it's not a bloodbath by any stretch. Compared to like battles like Gettysburg, I mean, this is really there's no comparison. It's a fairly small battle. But what you have to understand about battles in the Indian Territory and battles out west, size is not as important as you might think. I mean, you might say, well, of course, they didn't have a 100,000-man force. Well, a 100,000-man force could not survive in the Indian Territory. It couldn't get fed. It would be very difficult to move it. I mean, the Army has a phrase that they use called attritional advancement. In other words, when you're advancing, you're suffering attrition just simply by advancing. It's taking calories to get the men forward. It's taking calories to get the horses forward. You have to carry those with you because they're not out there to find in the Indian Territory. So this is something to keep in mind. So you have 13 killed, 62 wounded. It's not that bad. But Honey Springs has a significance that far outweighs the numbers. And the big one is the Honey Springs Depot is gone. The Federals now control the Texas Road, which means they control the Indian Territory, which means the Confederates' ability to cause problems in Missouri and to force the Federals to waste troops in Missouri and Arkansas is going to be significantly limited in this region now. They can't sustain conventional operations anymore. The area between the area between the Red River and the Arkansas River is going to essentially become a no man's land where anarchy reigns. Guerrillas will be the king in that area now. Because the Federals have no reason to advance past the Arkansas River. There's really nothing there. They got what they wanted. They controlled the Texas Road. They destroyed the Honey Springs Depot. To use large forces in that region now would just be a waste of resources. And so what the Confederates and their Indian allies then start doing is they start engaging guerrilla operations. Because even if they wanted to, I mean, yes, you could certainly go around the Federals at Fort Gibson, but how would you feed your men? What's there to feed them? There's no population there. The farms have all been destroyed. The livestock has been destroyed or moved. People aren't bringing in crops, so how are you going to feed yourself? So to take a large force north of the Arkansas River for the Confederates is just not real. You have to use these small guerrilla units. And again, widespread guerrilla warfare. This is going to make it a nightmare for civilians in the region, the few who are left. It's going to be anarchy. I mean, if you want to travel anywhere between the Red and the Arkansas River after the Battle of the Honey Springs, you essentially have to take a bodyguard with you. And I don't mean one, I mean a group of people. Because you're going to be attacked by guerrillas. It's guaranteed. In fact, I think Blount said in a letter to somebody, the stupidest person I could imagine is the person who thinks he can ride from Missouri to Texas without any, and expect to get there safely. It's that dangerous. Again, the Federals now control the Texas Road, and that means they control the Indian Territory. That means it's going to be much... The guerrillas in Missouri are not going to get supplies as easily as they were before. It's going to be much harder for them to do that. Now, it doesn't mean they cease operating. It just means the scale and scope of their operations is going to be significantly curtailed. And the Federals are going to capture, I mean, the victory of Honey Springs is such a bizarre thing. And like Schofield didn't even know about it until Blount told him. So Schofield's like, oh yeah, wait, but you fought a battle? I didn't tell you to do that. Why are you doing that? And he's like, oh, and I did win, by the way. Blount says, I did win the battle, by the way. And Blount lords that over Schofield to no end, which drives Schofield nuts. But the Confederates realize at this point that they can't even hold Fort Smith. And Fort Smith is just, let me show you the map here. Fort Smith is just here across the river, across the border. Fort Smith is also a key place for the Indian Territory as well. The Confederates realize they just can't hold it anymore. And so they abandoned Fort Smith, and the Federals are going to occupy Fort Smith on September 1st, and then on September 10th, they're going to capture Little Rock. Now, that expedition comes from Arkansas Post up to Devall's Bluff and then over here. That's an interesting campaign in and of itself. But with the capture of Little Rock, now the Federals control the entire Arkansas River line. And that's going to, again, make it much harder for supplies for the guerrillas. The guerrillas are slowly going to be strangled for weapons and munitions and these kinds of things. Now, of course, the Federals might just get rid of them right now. That's not, if any of you study counterinsurgencies, rarely do counterinsurgencies end like that. They kind of whimper and fizzle out as opposed to something like that. But the Federals have accomplished their goals here. They have finally managed to conquer the Arkansas River Valley. And that line is going to work until, of course, Price is going to take an army over that. And I'm sure that, you know, that Kyle's going to talk about that with the lecture today. But this is the Texas Road, all this, everything is working in the Federals' favor here. And that means that they can start shipping troops in Arkansas, Missouri, out to the Western Theater, and in rare cases to the Eastern Theater, mainly to the Western Theater. They go to Sherman's forces in Tennessee and Georgia. And with that,